My name is Isha Gupta, and I'm a freshman.
Hello, my name is Ayla Sadiqnajad, and I'm a senior.
Hi, I'm Risha Bhatt, and I'm a senior.
Hi, I'm Kate Richardson, I'm a senior.
Hi, I'm Reese Wyden, I'm a junior.
Hi, I'm Lucinda Schaefer, I'm a sophomore.
Hi, I'm Anna Banks, I'm a sophomore.
I'm Maya Debnath, and I'm a junior.
And hi, everyone. My name is Sean Messimoni. I'm a junior. And this year, I founded the Menlo Voices for Hope Committee, which you see on stage with me right now. I am so thrilled to be able to stand on stage today and share this incredibly meaningful event with all of you. I distinctly remember what life was like almost 2 years ago, being so far from from campus, my friends, my teachers, for so long, put such a toll on both my physical and mental health. As I reflect on those times, I recognize how universal this feeling was for everyone in this room, for students and teachers alike. On Thursday, in fact, the CDC released a statement that 4 out of every 10 teenagers reported that they felt profoundly impacted by feelings of stress, anxiety, loneliness, and hopelessness. In their words, this issue is a cry for help. Throughout the lockdown, I always found myself turning to music and songwriting to get through challenging times. This is why I'm here today, and why I'm so proud to see this auditorium filled with students, parents, and faculty members who shared similar experiences during the pandemic and are passionate about this issue. This afternoon, you're going to hear from an incredibly talented array of student performers, faculty performers, guest speakers, and student speakers. I'd now like to invite our head of school, Mr. Healy, to kick this event off, and we hope you enjoy the show.
Good afternoon and welcome. Welcome to Menlo School. If you're not a student or a faculty member here, welcome to this beautiful hall. When we built this 2 years ago, we imagined that today, an event like today might be possible. And somehow, seeing a student-run, student-initiated event for the larger community is a fitting way to have one of the first events to open this new hall. I'd like to thank the students who made today possible, and I wonder if you would join me in thanking all of those students that you saw up here on the stage just a moment ago. In particular, I'd like to thank Sean Messimoni, who imagined this event into being through a great deal of passion and hard work and care. Sean, thank you for bringing us all together today. I'd like to touch on a couple of things with my remaining time today. The first is this. Today's event is an example of why this school exists. The sole purpose of this institution and the amazing resources that it provides to a relatively small number of students on this planet is to send graduates out into the world to make a positive impact. At a time in our society where empathy measures are at an all-time low, where division and polarization and disparity are as great as I have seen them in my lifetime, we need people who are thinking about more than themselves. We need people who see it as their responsibility to tend to others. Who have adopted a collectivist view of the world rather than one that's oriented towards individual rights. What Sean and his team have put together today is an example of students practicing making an impact in our world. Agency and optimism are in short supply in the young today, as I observe them anyway, and it's therefore no surprise that mental health challenges are surfacing in the many ways that they are. Many in our society are quick to assign the blame for the current mental health challenges to a global pandemic, and certainly COVID has been a magnifier. But to my way of thinking, our loss of connection to each other, the glorification of contempt in our society, the fact that we're not seeing each other as we once did, that we're not known to each other, the absence of empathy and connection, together with the dearth of optimism and agency that I just spoke of, it's no wonder that we're seeing the trends that we're seeing in our most vulnerable populations in society. most centrally our children, which makes today's event all the more critical. This concert is a countercultural act of defiant optimism. It's providing the students involved and all of you the agency that we possess. It reminds us that we're not alone and in the power of community. Today's event is more than a concert to raise awareness and funding for a crisis. It is the solution to the crisis, in my mind. When our youngest daughter was a sophomore at this school 6 years ago, she was overwhelmed by depression and anxiety. She called out to help, called out for help from those of us who loved her through self-harm and self-medication. What ensued in our family was the hardest, most gut-wrenching, most painful period I've ever experienced. We had to renegotiate our commitments to each other as a family, our values as a family, and face the individual roles that we played in creating a dynamic that led to someone that we loved dearly to find the depths of desperation we thought we had insulated ourselves from. Through her intensive work as an individual and our collective work as a family, Sierra worked her way through her pain and would ultimately return to Menlo for her senior year to finish what she had started. She's continued her journey, sometimes seeing success clearly, sometimes hitting bottoms again that were painful for her and everyone around her in ways that I had not known possible. Now a thriving university student, her journey to health, maturity, and adjustment continues in a perfectly imperfect way. Our family knows the pain of the mental health crisis. I know what it means to watch the thing that you love more than anything in the world experiencing hurt and despair in ways that you cannot heal. But there are two lessons that I've learned through this pain that I want to share with you today. On the first morning that my wife and I went to visit our incredible daughter in the hospital, perhaps the lowest moment of my life, I somehow find myself sitting in a coffee shop nearby, not knowing how I got there and without a clue of what to do next. So I called the Menlo family that I had known had a child who'd been hospitalized for depression and anxiety and who was moving through it just a few months ahead of us. That parent took my call and sat with me for 2 hours on the phone, explaining every detail of their journey, admitting every flaw and every vulnerability in his own experience, sharing every moment of indecision and paralysis and fear. To this day, I believe that this parent was sent from above. He saved us. And while our family's journey was slightly different from his, the roadmap he described for me let me know that I wasn't a bad parent, that healing was possible. But mostly he let me know that I wasn't alone. As we progressed through what was to come, my amazing wife Deborah and I made a conscious decision to share our experiences if we were asked. So while we weren't going to lead with our stories at cocktail parties, if someone asked us where our daughter was, we weren't going to make up some story, but rather share unapologetically what had happened with her. We would share our worries and our fears, and we would share our hope. We committed to vulnerability just as that father had done for me that morning on the phone. And you can't believe how many people, when we started sharing, responded by sharing their own stories of mental health crises in their families. This in turn led us to understand how far from alone we were. You see, when you're in free fall, you'll grab onto anything that even resembles hope. And to know that we were surrounded by caring people who knew our pain gave us the power to face what was ahead. To this day, Deborah and I will take calls from people we know and people we've never met to talk about our experiences, just as that father had done for me in March of 2016. And that's the first valuable lesson for me. Community is built on vulnerability and honesty, and community is the only path out of despair. The second lesson might be counterintuitive. Our daughter, because of her experiences, the things that she's had to face and the growth that she's pursued for herself, is one of the strongest, most mature, most well-adjusted 22-year-olds I know. Her challenges are the source of her superpowers in this world. She's strong, introspective, honest, and wise beyond her years. She values her health and a clear head. She chooses friends who further her greatness rather than those who seek to tear her down to lift themselves up. She holds me to account in ways that are sometimes hard, but always helpful in getting me closer to being the person I want to be. She gives her older sisters sage advice, and she's one of the funniest, most self-effacing kids I know. Mental health challenges are not weakness. They're strength waiting to be born. I'm grateful and humbled to have been invited here today and proud that we have decided to come together as a community to empower our inspired children into agency and optimism for the challenges ahead. Thank you.
Hello, we're excited to be here today. We are the Old Menlo Medicine Band. We're gonna be playing for you The Wagon Wheel by Darius Rucker. And I'll introduce us. This is Tucker Gold on bass. Mr. Blick is our singer.
Howdy.
Mr. Carencio on fiddle. I'm Tanya Buxton on fiddle. And Mr. Peter Brown on guitar.
Well, academics are a passion and a vocation for us. Music has always been a joy. So we would like to share that joy with y'all. Peter?
One, two, three, four.
Heading down south to the land of the pines, I'm a thumbing my way out of North Carolina. Staring up the road and pray to God to see headlights. I made it down the coast, 17 hours, picking me a bouquet of dogwood flowers. And I'm hoping for Raleigh, I can see my baby tonight. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, any way you feel. Hey, mama, rock me. Rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, mama, rock me. Running from the cold up in New England, I was born to be a fiddler and an old-time string band. My baby plays the guitar, I pick a banjo now. Oh, North Country winters keep getting me down. Lost my money playing poker, so I had to leave town. But I ain't turning back to living that life no more. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, any way you feel. Hey, mama, rock me. Oh, rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, mama, rock me. Walking through the south, out of Roanoke, I caught a trucker out of Philly, had a nice long joke. But he's headed west from the Cumberland Gap to Jackson City, Tennessee. I gotta move on before the sun, I need my baby. I hear her calling my name, and I'm the only one. And if I die in Raleigh, at least I will die free. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, any way you feel. Hey, mama, rock me. Oh, rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, mama, rock me. Oh, rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, any way you feel. Hey, mama, rock me, oh, mama, rock me. Rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, mama, rock me.
Sole del Grande. It was composed by Alessandro Scarlatti, and it means to dethrone the night with sunrise.
Go. All right. It's great to be here. This is an incredible event you've put on, Sean, and so proud and really, really impressed and excited to be part of it because it's such a big and important event and issue that we're tackling for this time.
Thank you so much for being able to join us and say just a few words on some of the work that yourself and YouTube has been doing to address this really important issue. So I think just to start, throughout the pandemic, I post a lot of singing videos and composing videos on platforms like YouTube and TikTok and such. And through that, I truly discovered just the healing power music had. Even if I was just singing into a camera in my room, I just felt like it was such a great escape from the uncertainty of what was going on during that time. And I knew that a lot of people also shared similar feelings. Just platforms like social media platforms have cultivated such a meaningful community of performers and artists all across the world. Whether you're singing a song, a visual artist, or a dancer, anything, the arts and music just have this immense power to change the way we feel, view the world, and just improve our mental well-being overall. So I knew for sure that that's what I wanted this event to focus on, that intersection of the creative arts and how it improves our mental well-being. I have just another question for you. How has YouTube, or how will YouTube strive to reduce the stigma associated with mental health and seeking care?
Yeah, so we definitely understand at YouTube how important mental health is and what a big issue it is for youth. And we also know that a lot of times young people come to YouTube at the beginning of the challenges that they're facing in terms of looking for help, looking for community, and ways of better understanding what's going on. And so as a result, we do feel that we have a really big responsibility to make sure that we're providing answers and help and useful resources. We also, you mentioned this a little bit, but we as a company have the goal of reducing the stigma around mental health, because we know that all young people come and use YouTube, and we think that by talking about it openly, more people can get help. And so we've seen our creators talk about it a lot. We've funded a number of different events, productions for our creators to talk about it. And we actually have a number of licensed therapists on our platform. There's like Katie Morton, I don't know if you know her, or The Psych Show, or who are licensed therapists that talk about the events that they do. Or creators like Lele Pons, who I'm sure you know all the young people in the audience know, who had talked really openly about the OCD that she had. She actually did an original show with us. And we've really, truly believe that by having our creators talk openly about what they are going through, that that will enable their audiences and fans to be able to feel like they can go and talk about it with their families or friends and support, get help, ask for help. And so we've invested a lot there. We've also worked with a lot of different organizations to make sure that we're supplying relevant, helpful information, that what they're getting is coming from really trusted sources, and we'll continue to do a lot more there. So I want to hear a little bit about music. I know music has been something that you have really helped you. I've watched some of your videos, and I've seen you in many plays here at Menlo, and know you're very talented in drama and in video as well. So I'd love to hear a little bit more about how music and video helped you and inspired you to create Voices of Hope.
Definitely, thank you so much. To me, music is just so much more than just notes on a page. Singing and composing music just allows me to tell stories through the work I create, give voice to important topics like this evening's, and also just connect with myself and others. Especially just posting online, YouTube provided me, like I mentioned, an escape from reality in a sense. And I also think that this event, in essence, is that connection between music and mental well-being and its impact on our brain health. And I just cannot wait to continue sharing my music online and also just performing for the community and bringing people together, which is the whole purpose of this event, is to really bring our community together through the power of music.
And it's great that there are so many resources here at Menlo. I'm really thankful for that, and hopefully we can continue to make sure that all kids have access to the arts and so many of these valuable resources, which I agree are really, really important for kids everywhere in their development and expression, and very supportive of the arts and enabling that for young people.
Definitely, Menlo offers really great support systems for students. Another question I had for you is, is, how has YouTube overall addressed the issue of mental health, and what initiatives are going to be employed or have been employed to address this issue? I know you mentioned a lot of creators on the platforms have already been speaking out on the issue, which is really powerful and impactful for teens. If you had any additional words for that.
So, you know, there are many things that we've been doing. You know, we definitely recognize how mental health has been a key challenge for people during the pandemic. And, you know, we definitely saw the Surgeon General's warning. You mentioned the latest one that was put out with how much young people have been impacted. And we wanted to make sure that we are providing really relevant information for people. And, you know, first step was just making sure that creators felt like they could talk about it. And you know, there's just such a broad range of mental health issues that I guarantee you, whatever the issue is, you can find someone on YouTube who's talking about it, and you can find a community who has gathered around that and is offering support. So that was the first thing, was just making sure that we had our creators and community that were talking about it. But we also then went and wanted to make sure that we were working with literally the best medical institutions to raise up that information, so that if people were coming, like I want to think if one of my kids was coming and looking for health information, that they would find information that came from really, really trusted sources. And so we've worked with literally dozens and dozens of the best medical institutions in the US, and we've expanded that. We actually just launched it in five more countries to do that same equal, like regardless of what the language is or the country, to make sure that that information would be at the top of the page, depending upon what the user types in, whether it's anxiety or depression, that they're gonna get it from trusted organizations who have are putting the right information there and telling people where they can get help. We also work with Crisis Text Line, which does suicide prevention, and so we know that, like, in the worst cases, like, we're gonna make sure that we're referring people to places where they can go and get help, and we know it really is making a difference. We work closely with these organizations. We follow how many people are looking for this information, and we'll continue to do more for sure. So we definitely see it's an important area, and I just have seen that too from my own experience with kids, is that this, like, the pandemic happened at a time where a lot of kids were supposed to be, you were all supposed to be out and, like, you know, expanding your wings and flying and getting your driver's license and, you know, having fun and getting in trouble, like doing all the things probably that you want to do that parents maybe feel mixed about, but it's like normal, and you weren't able to do it during this time. And so I think just as certainly as parents, we all understand that it was not a normal time, and that everyone needs some time to recover and get help for this. So, you know, we'll continue to offer as many resources as we can and support kids and adults too. I mean, this isn't just a kids issue, it's everyone. There are people, I mean, we see that with work too. You know, we're dealing with tough issues at work, so we talk a lot about mental health at work, making sure people take a break, that they know how to balance work-life balance, like what are all the different ways people can get that relief from stress if they need it. So, and YouTube does also offer out, like, a lot of, we saw a huge number of, like, meditation, yoga, all of those types of services for people during the pandemic that otherwise we know wouldn't have been able to get it. So, so anyway, we'd love to hear, you know, what's next for Voices for Hope, and how can we all support you in terms of continuing to do more with this organization?
Definitely. Just to start, I would be so thrilled to put on another event like this. It definitely was a lot of work, but it was probably the most fun I've ever had organizing an event like this. Getting to immerse myself in this gorgeous new auditorium that Menlo's built, it was truly an amazing experience. And I think just the more opportunities that we give Menlo students to showcase their talent to the community, the better. I also hope to see this student group flourish into something even bigger beyond my years at Menlo. It would be amazing to see this become, like, even an annual tradition at Menlo. And I chose the name Voices for Hope because it is specific but general enough to be applied to any important issue that a student feels passionate about. And just bringing our community together to talk about an issue like that is really what I hope to see. I'm also so proud to be a Menlo student and work amongst incredibly passionate individuals who hope to make a difference in the community. To answer your last bit, I think the best definition of support is what we have here today. Having audience members coming out to support this cause, to support student initiatives, and it's just incredible to see how our community continues to support the arts and mental well-being for their students. But I just wanted to thank you so much for taking some time today to answer a few questions, and we hope you enjoy the rest of the show.
Sure. No, I was so glad to be here. When you wrote to me, I was like, oh, yes, of course. I have to come here. This is an important issue, and I'm glad to see that you took the initiative to make this happen, and I'm looking forward to seeing the rest of the program and all the incredible speakers that you have lined up. So it's great to see everyone who came out, and thank you so much for organizing this.
Of course. Thank you.
Once again, I'm Anna Banks, and I'm going to be singing an original song called Like a Bird.
Like a bird, we could fly away, maybe on a wish upon a dandelion. Like a bird, we could watch the world, find that it's a precious thing we live in. It comes with our imagination, a sunny sky, birds flying by. Think it a perfect day.
Miss me when I'm gone, when I'm gone, when I'm gone. would like to introduce our next guest speaker of the evening, Dr. Patrice Christosimo. Dr. Christosimo is a child clinical psychologist and program manager for CHC's Clinical Services Division. Passionate about working with children, adolescents, parents, and families, Dr. Christosimo has extensive experience conducting comprehensive psychological assessments and providing evidence-based treatments. She completed an APA-accredited pre-doctoral psychology internship at Lucile Packard's Children's Hospital. She continued training in comprehensive psychological assessments and evidence-based treatments of anxiety and mood disorders, autism and developmental disabilities, and eating disorders through postdoctoral fellowship with the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Patrice Christosimo.
Thank you, Sean Mezzimoni, for reaching out to the Children's Health Council for this really impressive and amazing event. We at CHC are deeply grateful for the wonderful show and support from the Menlo School community for the last few weeks. What a major achievement for the Menlo Voices for Hope team.
It's truly an honor for CHC to be the recipient of this generosity and to share the stage with all of these very talented performers and fellow speakers. As you know, the Children's Health Council has been part of our community here in the Bay Area for nearly 70 years. We provide comprehensive and integrated services for learning differences and mental health to young people and their families. Your support ensures that thousands of families in our community can get the help and care they need. Therapies, evaluations, support groups. You help fund our financial assistance program, our community-based services in Ravenswood, our free educational programs for parents and educators, and our online resource library. Your support makes it possible for the staff and clinicians at CHC to serve all who need our support, regardless of their ability to pay. Thank you. Over the past couple years, youth mental health has risen to a national crisis. Please know that the Children's Health Council is here for you and for our community. If you want to find out more, be sure to visit our website at www.chconline.org or speak to some of our staff here tonight. I'd like to take a few minutes to walk everyone through a mindfulness exercise I often use with my clients to help them feel more grounded, centered, and open. Mindfulness can be a way to reduce stress. However, mindfulness in and of itself is not just that. It's a way of paying attention in a particular way, on purpose, present-focused, not multitasking, and non-judgmentally. With so much going on in our lives, especially for our young people, mindfulness is a great way to start to help gain perspective on our emotional well-being, and it's a tool that you can use anywhere or any time. Mindfulness exercises are a core part of a practice called dialectical behavioral therapy, which is an evidence-based treatment. At CHC, my colleagues and I run a DBT skills group for middle schoolers and high school teens. You can find out more on our website if you're interested. So let's get started. I invite you to begin by bringing your attention into your body. If it feels comfortable for you, you can close your eyes. You can notice your body seated, wherever you're seated. feeling the weight of your body on the chair. And take a few deep breaths. Inhaling through your nose, moving the air down deep into your belly, and exhaling through your mouth. And let's do that again. Inhale through your nose, and exhale through your mouth. As you take a deep breath, bring in more oxygen and liven the body. And as you exhale, have a sense of relaxing more deeply. You can begin to notice your feet. Do they dangle? Or do they rest on the floor? Just notice the sensation of your feet. The weight, the pressure, any vibrations, the heat. Don't feel the need to make any changes. Just notice. And now you can notice your legs against the chair. Any pressure? Pulsing? The heaviness? Or the lightness? And continue to breathe. Deep inhale in. Big exhale out. Notice your back against your chair. Bring your attention now into your stomach area. If your stomach feels tense or tight, let it soften. And now notice your hands. Are your hands tense or tight? See if you can allow them to soften. Now bring your awareness into your arms. Feel any sensation in your arms. If you notice any tension or tightness, invite yourself to soften and relax. And notice your back and your shoulders. Allow the muscles in your back and your shoulders to soften. Create a little bit more space between your ears and your shoulders. Settle in. Notice your neck and your throat. Let them be soft, relaxed. Bring your awareness to your jaw and soften your jaw. Let your face and your facial muscles be soft. Then notice your whole body present. Scan your body from head to toe. And if you notice any tightness, tension, invite yourself to relax a bit more. And take one more breath, the deepest breath you've taken all day. Inhale through your nose, deep into your belly, and exhale. Be aware of your whole body as best as you can. Your breath is always with you, and I invite you to consider this exercise anytime you might need a bit more space for relaxation. I will ring the bell in a few moments. Allow the sound of the bell to ring through your ears and invite yourself, when you're ready, to open your eyes. This is where I live. This is where I travel to. This is how I fall. This is how I dream. Underground.
Some of our singers are also students at the Menlo School, and we're thinking of Sean Nesimony and Anna Banks, who are two students who have been extremely involved in preparation and organization for this event. So a huge thank you to Sean, Anna, and everyone else involved with the Menlo team. Thank you so much for extending your space to us, and thank you so much for sharing your stage. The pandemic has really highlighted how important singing in choir is to all of us. Choir provides a communal space, and it provides an escape from the stress that we're currently experiencing in light of all of these global conflicts, and also just the stress that comes with being a teenager and a high school student in the Bay Area. So all the music that we've chosen to perform today was chosen specifically because these are songs we love to sing together. The first piece you heard was called Sylvie. It's an arrangement of a popular American spiritual. The second is an arrangement of Billy Joel's And So It Goes, which I'm sure some of you or your parents are familiar with. And then the third piece we're going to sing is another spiritual, this one called Down in the River to Pray, and it's a piece that was specifically arranged by our core, by our conductor, Jace Wittig, for this small group of choreo. If you have any questions about our organization, feel free to check out our website or to come to speak with any of us after the show. Again, a huge thank you to the Menlo School. We are very, very happy to be able to represent this cause, which is so dear to us as students who feel that music is integral to our happiness and success. So thank you again.
Where the starry crown goes. Hi everyone, this is Brother Ramesh from St. Patrick's, Anglo-Indian School, Chennai, Tamil Nadu, India. Children risk being among its biggest victims. Menlo, Voice for Hope, has taken such a wonderful initiative to take care of the mental well-being during the pandemic. Wishing you all the very best. May your effort bear fruit in all its richness. Thank you. God bless.
Of liberation, my Lord, it still has to feel your power. The blind and the deaf, the dumb and the maimed, all need to feel your healing touch. The world stands in need of liberation, my Lord, it still has to learn to love. There are those who have eyes but refuse to see the around. There are those who have ears but refuse to hear the cries of those in agony. There are those who have mouths but refuse to speak against injustice done to some. There are those who have hands but refuse to reach them out in love and charity. The world stands in need of liberation, my Lord, it still has to feel your power. The blind and the deaf, the dumb and the maimed, all need to feel your healing touch. The world stands in need of liberation, my Lord, it still has to learn to love. True community, and we know that we all have the talent to love, but leave it buried in ourselves. The world stands in need of liberation, my Lord, it still has to feel your power. The blind and the deaf, the dumb and the maimed, all need to feel your healing touch. The world stands in need of liberation, my Lord, it still has to learn to love. It still has to learn to love. It still has to learn to love.
I am Vijaya Kennedy, an instrumentalist and a music teacher of St. Patrick's Anglo-Indian High Secondary School, Chennai. On behalf of our school, I would like to thank Mr. Siamesmani for giving us a golden opportunity to be a part of this renowned benefit concert. Our school choir has showcased a video song. Hope it will be a blessing to all. God bless.
Thank you.
please welcome Dr. Leanne Williams, the founding director of the Center for Precision Mental Health and Wellness at Stanford University. Within her center, Dr. Williams leads the PAN Lab for Precision Psychiatry and Translational Neuroscience. Today, Dr. Williams will share some of the research she and her team have done in the field of mental health care. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Leanne Williams.
What do Lady Gaga, Buzz Aldrin, and The Rock have in common? They have all battled chronic depression. Depression is a disease. It can be a deadly disease. Around the world, every 40 seconds, another person will end their life due to depression. You can find these numbers on the World Health Organization website. But now we can do something about it. We have a solution. At my Center for Precision Mental Health and Wellness at Stanford University, we have developed a new technology for scanning your brain and diagnosing your type of depression. This technology has never been seen before. The foundations for the technology have been published in over 350 scientific peer-reviewed articles. Because of this technology, we can get the right treatment to you sooner. I have characterized at least 8 types of depression. They involve different regions of the brain, and I measure them using functional MRI. Let me tell you about a couple of them. One of them involves the amygdala. The amygdala is an almond-shaped region of the brain, deep inside your brain. It responds to stress and it codes negative emotion. If the amygdala is overactive, you may feel like you are constantly in alarm mode. You may find it easier to remember negative experiences instead of positive ones. Another type of depression involves the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. This is a prefrontal region right at the front of your brain. It is a kind of executive. It helps us control our thoughts and our actions. If this region is underactive, we may find it hard to concentrate. Decisions may feel overwhelming. Because these different types of depression involve different brain regions and different processes, they require different treatments. And because we now have a way to measure them, we can rapidly expand and add new measures, including digital sensors and apps. My passion for changing the way that we understand mental health through understanding the brain began when I was very young as many of you are. Details and information about our new technology and these different types of depression are on our website. You may find it helpful to read this information for yourself and share it with your family and your friends. It is a way to know about your own brain. As individuals and as a community, I hope that we will share this knowledge about the new technology and new insights to better understand depression, better understand mental health, and do better to treat it. There are many brilliant students here today. I am in awe of your musical excellence and your courage. I would like to give a special acknowledgement to Sean Nesimone for founding this event and for his leadership in the student-led Creative Sciences Communication Group, which is a key initiative of my center for sharing this knowledge to many more young people and our future leaders. With this information, we don't have to accept that another person will end their life every 40 seconds. We can change the numbers now. We can change our future for mental health. Thank you for inviting me to participate in such an inspiring event as Menlo Voices for Hope.
Thank you all so much for coming to this fabulous event. And second of all, I'd like to thank my friends who are juniors and seniors who spent their hard work and time in helping me perform this piece for you all. Thank you very much.
Here's the loss. With my dad about halfway through the pandemic. We had both had horrible days, me accidentally lighting our cat on fire in chem, and him with the sick patient. And so we had turned on some good old Shania Twain to brighten our moods. Our nightly ritual consisted of a vicious battle for aux control to show the other which country music artist we had discovered that day, and we would blast it throughout our home speakers while cleaning up from dinners. My mom and brother promptly chose this half an hour to walk our puppy and escape the twang of banjos and the crooning of country songs that often highlight love and beer. For us, this was our moment of contentment. Country tells stories and creatively brings them to life. It was where we both smiled the most throughout the day and did our funky little dances and chased ourselves throughout the kitchen with dirty utensils, and we laughed our ugly laughs. The ones that you can't hold back. Playing these same country tunes after a bad day was a way for us to coerce our minds back into the mood of the memories associated with the music that we loved so much. We could coerce our minds back into the emotions of what we were being fed through our ears, because what we were living at that point in quarantine, throughout all of quarantine, was not substantial enough. I was in a pensive mindset, as one is after having almost burned out a member of the family. So concentrating on the pulsating bass, feeling the infectious groove tingling through my limbs, I remember turning to my dad. With a quizzical expression, I asked him if he thought he would still be alive if music didn't exist. Shania Twain yodeling in the background, we sat in silence for some time. He cocked his head slightly to the side and squinted his eyes through the mid-afternoon sun, as if waiting for the answer to fly in front of his dashboard. He turned to me and said, in his typical dad fashion, "It's not a black or white answer, you know, it's a whole gray zone, somewhere in between." I sputtered enough until he put his hand up in resignation. What he said afterwards has stuck with me forever. I don't know if I would be alive. If I was, it would be a sad existence for sure. And I couldn't have said it better myself. This is the thing about music. It's like a film you can put over your mind that tints things with certain colors. You can see and process the world with the spirit of what is being blasted into your ears. It gives us that reset, that on-call therapist, that quick and easy validation of feelings, that sign our minds are looking for to chase after someone or something. When the emotions that we are living in real life are unwanted, music gives us alternate emotions to fuel our minds and thoughts, alternate versions of life to be content with, alternate from the pandemic. To me, this describes the healing that exists within music. It's that pair of 3D glasses that you can put on that makes the world pop in different ways, sometimes unreal. And that helped make my quarantine less of a quarantine and more of a fantasy novel. Thank you.
And so next, I will be performing a song called Cover Me Up by Morgan Wallen. And to give you a little bit of background on the song, it is about a man who is kind of calling after his long-lost lover and asking to rekindle that flame. And to me, that resonated with me, not for the same reasons as his did, but for the reasons that while we were in quarantine, what I really wanted was real life again. A heart on the run keeps a hand on a gun, can't trust anyone. I was so sure what I needed was more, try to shoot out the sun. The days when we raged, we flew off the page, such damage. But I made it through, 'cause somebody knew I was meant for someone. So girl, leave your boots by the bed, we ain't leaving this room. So someone needs medical help or the magnolia. It's cold in this house, and I ain't going out to chop wood. So cover me up, and know you're enough to use me for good. Put your faith to the test when I tore off your dress and Richmond's on high. I'm sobered up, I swore off that stuff forever this time. And the old lovers say, I thought it'd be me who helped him get home. But home was a dream, one that I'd never seen till you came along. Thank you.
Favorite thing in the world. Whenever I'm awkwardly introducing myself and I'm asked about my hobbies and interests, music is consistently my first and sometimes only named hobby and or interest. When I was a kid, there were a few staple albums that I had downloaded on my iPod, which was my most prized possession that I had until I was like 13. Plastic Beach by the Gorillaz, Life in Cartoon Motion by Mika, Saint Elsewhere by Gnarls Barkley, which consequently earned me the nickname for my brother of Gnarls, since I listened to it so much. Those albums are implanted in my mind like nothing else. I could sing each one from start to finish right now, unprompted. And I still listen to them this day when I'm needing comfort, like a baby blanket that is sewn with the threads of notes, melodies, harmonies, and familiar words. As I got older, music stayed consistent in my life, but transformed into, as I like to call it, a 3D experience, and then a 4D experience. When I was 11, I started feeling things for the first time, as one does in the preteen years. I started having crushes, and I started to feel anxious, and I started to randomly get mad, and I didn't really know why, and I didn't know what to do with these feelings until one Christmas when I was with my extended family in Mexico for some reason. It was windy, like really, really windy, like I would be knocked over by the wind, windy. And so I was kind of just in my room the whole time. And I had gotten this notebook for Christmas, and I just started writing in it. I started writing the worst songs and lyrics imaginable. And I have never really stopped. Whenever anything happens, I write. I get my heart broken by some senior guy when I'm a sophomore, which I don't recommend. I write like 28 songs about it. I get stuck in a pandemic as a newly 16-year-old and subsequently lose a lot of friends. Write closer to 50 songs about it. Get my heart broken by my first girl boyfriend. Write a whole album about it. It has been my consistent form of self-therapy, of self-expression, and of understanding myself. As I've grown up, my anxiety has morphed and shifted, and a lot has happened to me over the last 7 years. But writing lyrics has been my number one go-to and has stayed by my side. That's what experiencing music at a 3D level is like. I started playing saxophone when I was 9 out of defiance and a love for jazz. When I was 9, I started in the school band and was told I should play clarinet and or flute because I was a girl. And I said, screw that, I want to play saxophone because I heard John Coltrane one time on 91.1, the Bay Area's jazz station. I have now been playing saxophone for 9 years, taking private lessons for the first 5, and joining Menlo's jazz band when I was a freshman. Playing music usurps listening, it usurps writing, it usurps every other experience that one can have in life. The first time I took a solo in jazz band, it really sucked. And it sucked for pretty much the entire year. But over my 4 years, I've learned so much. I have learned confidence, I have learned what it is to solo, and I have learned what it is to collaborate with other musicians and discovered a bond with the members of jazz band that I've never been able to replicate anywhere else. This is the 4D of music experience. Creating it through your own self-expression and love, sharing it with others, and being recognized for understanding and respecting music for the power that it holds. My teachers over the years have always said that music is a language of its own, and I used to roll my eyes at that because it's such a cliche, but unfortunately it's also true. Trading solos, messing with harmonies under someone else's solo, feeling yourself being lifted by the rest of the band, feeling yourself communicate in ways that you can't really explain in words with other people, that's magic. My mental health has fluctuated over the years with intense waves of anxiety, fear, depression, and PTSD rolling over me. And I have never found an antidote, a therapist, or a drug that makes me feel the way that music does. Listening to songs such as On Melancholy Hill by the Gorillaz, This Feeling by Alabama Shakes, Brandy by the Looking Glass, Knees by Ocean Alley, or Do You Realize by the Flaming Lips, calms me down instantly. Music has been the strongest love of my life, the common thread connecting all of my experiences, the light at the end of every single tunnel, and the reason that I return to when I can find none in other places. Music is my world, music is my escape, and music makes up the fabric of my life. Thank you.
I'm Melissa Jensen-Young. I teach in math and physics here in Menlo. And today I'm going to play the oboe, a piece by Benjamin Britten, written in 1951. The selection is called Six Metamorphoses After Ovid, and I'll play the first movement, Pan, who played upon a reed pipe, which was his beloved syrinx. So listen for a pan pipe or a flute pipe, like that, ooh, ooh, like runs. I play better than that. Anyway, hashtag Ovid, not COVID.
Thank you. called Long Term Destination, which I wrote last summer, and I hope you like it. You're the one from my home city, no one else is quite as pretty. I would read every book that you've read, and it's 5 years in the running. You've never looked quite this stunning lying here on this bed of grass. As you laugh with me, and in your eyes are a million possibilities, with freckles like the constellations, nostalgic sensations. I know you're my long-term destination. Golden locks to make all of us swoon, dipped in red when the petals bloom. You're the one I want to run home to. There's one day I'll always remember, back in 2015 September. Oh, on our schoolyard's field, as we walk and you talk to me, and in your words are a million possibilities, with freckles like the constellations, nostalgic sensations. I know you're my long-term destination. Golden locks to make all of us swoon, dipped in red when the petals bloom. You're the one I want to run home to. Well, I've waited for these 5 long years, collected my 500 tears. Now I don't want to spend another day. Constellations, nostalgic sensations. I know you're my long-term destination. Golden locks to make all of us swoon, dipped in red when the petals bloom. You're the one I want to run home to, with your freckles like the constellations, nostalgic sensations. I hope you know that you're my long-term
destination. Well, sometimes I go out by myself and I look across the water. And I think of all the things of what you're doing, and in my head I paint a picture. Cause since I've come on home, well, my body's been a mess, and I miss your ginger hair and the way you like to dress. Won't you come on over, stop making a fool out of me. Come on.
of water. You look really good. And I think of all the things of what you're doing. And in my head, I paint a picture. Since I've come on home, well, my body's been a mess. And I miss your ginger hair and the way you like to dress. So, won't you come on over? Stop making a fool out of me. Why don't you come on over, Valerie? Valerie. Valerie.
I'm Lloyd Miner, Dean of the Stanford School of Medicine. I want to thank Menlo Voices for Hope for organizing this meaningful event, which I regret not being able to attend in person. Over the past 2 years, the pandemic has taken a profound toll on all of us, including on our mental health. Few of us imagined we'd be isolated from friends and family for so long, that our routines and way of life would be so totally disrupted. For me, in times of stress and times of loneliness, music has provided tremendous joy and healing. It's been an important part of my life since I began learning to play the cello as a child. And certainly, it's helped me through the pandemic's toughest moments. The arts and humanities offer a unique window into both ourselves and the human condition. That's why events like this one are vital. Because while science helps us understand the human body and mind, it is art that can illuminate things like suffering, love, grief, and hope. Have a wonderful rest of your evening.
Hi everyone, it's Ro Khanna here. Teenage mental health is such an issue in our country. I hear, unfortunately, young people who are suffering from anxiety, suffering from depression, concerned about their life, their stress. And we have to deal with it. We have to make sure that social media isn't aggravating it. We have to make sure that we're talking to young people, that they know they have peers and parents who they can speak to. It is so important that we recognize that you can't have anything else in life unless you have good health and good mental health, and that people need to be heard, they need our support, and that we need to recognize the issue that exists with so many teenagers. Thank you for the work you're doing on it.
Hi there, my name is Shadila Stepan, and my pronouns are she, her, and hers. I'm the communications and creative manager at Born This Way Foundation, a nonprofit started by Lady Gaga and her mom, Cynthia Germanotta. The mission of Born This Way Foundation is to support youth mental health and work with young people to build a kinder and braver world. We are endlessly inspired by this generation and the many ways in which you are using your time, treasures, and talents to build this kinder and braver world, to inspire each other, and to lean into conversations about mental health.
That's why Born This Way Foundation partnered with our friends at JAG.org to create the Be There Certificate, a free, self-paced, interactive online mental health course available in English, French, and Spanish, designed with and for young people so that they know how to better support their friends while also caring for their own mental health. To learn more and get your certification, visit BeThereCertificate.org.
everybody. My name is Stephen Minning, and I'm the Creative Arts Director here at Menlo. And I'd like to thank all of you so much for joining us this evening for this very meaningful concert with all these young students. I'm so thrilled to see the student-led activities like this supporting the creative arts here at Menlo. And in that vein, I would like to invite all the performers and participants on stage here that worked on the show. Come on up. Come on up, guys. Everybody, come on out, everybody. Let's take a look here. The arts are such an integral part of a student's educational experience, and we strongly believe that, like the message of this event, that the creative arts have profound effects on all of our mental health. The Menlo Voices of Hope Committee partnered with the Children's Health Council, an organization based in the Bay Area that provides mental health and education services to families regardless of financial background and geographical location. And I'm so proud to announce that the Menlo Voices for Hope Committee raised $25,000 for CFC. And now, Kate Richardson, would you step forward?
Yes.
Hello.
We just wanted to give a special thank you to both Sean and Ms. Petrasch. Of course, this is Sean's brainchild. He's been working on this for over a year, and it has been absolutely incredible for all of us working along his side, seeing the passion that he has for these topics. And we just wanted to give you a little something as a thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for a wonderful evening. Support these students, support everything that's happening towards our supporting mental health and all the conditions thereof. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a great night.